Fayola Cooper and Saelese Haynes, both lawyers, immigration lawyers at that, specializing in immigration. And, you know, it's very current, especially with the whole issue with the Cubans who were arrested and so on. And people are asking, what are the laws surrounding immigration in Trinidad and Tobago?
Well, at this point in time, our Immigration Act clearly states and clearly outlines the circumstances under which immigrants or non-nationals can enter our country. Under the Act itself, though, it basically specifies, of course, you can enter as a tourist. However, in the unique circumstances that we are currently facing with all the persons, all the immigrants from, for instance, Cuba and Venezuela seeking asylum in our country, the Act itself does not provide for them seeking asylum in Trinidad.
Mm-hmm.
So what we are finding is that right now Trinidad is in a unique situation because our legislation does not directly provide for asylum seekers. However, if you are entering as a tourist, and if you can in fact satisfy the requirements, which are being able to sustain yourself while you are in the country, you can enter.
Yes, but Amnesty International spoke about Trinidad and Tobago being signatories to the UN Convention. Can you explain how this impacts the whole immigration situation?
Yeah, sure. So Trinidad and Tobago has acceded to the 1951 Convention and a later protocol, a 1967 protocol. But as you probably would know, we were late to the game. So we would have done this in November 2000, and we would have had to file certificates of accession. So what that meant is that the provisions of the convention are binding in Trinidad and Tobago. Mm-hmm. And that's what Amnesty International and other members of our fraternity have been saying.
Mm-hmm.
But what the convention provides, the convention and its protocol provide, is a framework, a sort of bare bones, what is to be done.
Right.
But we don't have any local legislation to then flesh that out a bit and say how we go about getting to the targets that we need to meet.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, how are we going to treat with people who, in the interim, while they're seeking refugee status or they're seeking asylum, how they're going to be fed, clothed, housed, what sort of concessions are going to be provided to them.
Yeah.
And in terms of that, there's nothing in the local legislation that can provide for that.
So what we would need to do in order to deal with this, we would definitely need to supplement the local legislation to provide for refugees and a person seeking asylum.
And what exists in terms of precedents internationally that we can look to? In terms of other countries, because the situation of refugees is not a new thing,
for sure.
Mm-hmm.
In the United Kingdom, for example, there are laws and practices as well. So if you look at their immigration websites and their border control agencies, they have outlined procedures. So somebody entering as a refugee, once you let them know at border control that you're fleeing your country from persecution, at that point you will be taken in, asked to do a questionnaire, you would be referred to the relevant authorities, and they are able to deal with applications fairly quickly.
Yes.
I was looking at their site and it says that usually within 6 months a decision is made.
Yeah.
So then at that point the person would either be returned or asked to leave the country if it's not a genuine case. And if it is a genuine case, then things would be put in place for them to be integrated into the society and they'll be able to work and live and find a path to permanent residency.
But that is if they come through the correct borders.
Yes.
But we've
yes.
seen cases, of course, everyone
yes,
has seen on social media where people
yes.
come through on boats, on the coastlines
yeah,
and
definitely.
So on. So what happens in a case like that?
Well, what I have noted is that the United Nations office in Trinidad and Tobago has actually provided a forum for persons seeking refugee status to actually apply. There are some requirements which basically you have to give all information in regards to yourself and all your family members that will be seeking asylum. In terms of the process, in terms of the waiting time, I think that is one of the issues that the person seeking asylum will be facing.
Locally,
locally, because what you're seeing is that all of the bodies dealing with these situations are not working hand in hand. So although the United Nations Office on Body in Trinidad and Tobago is trying to assist as well as Amnesty International, there is going to be some obstacles due to the fact that all of the agencies are not working hand in hand
together.
Yeah. Yes.
So what do you think would be the way forward given the current situation?
Well, as Ms. Cooper mentioned, is definitely something where we need to look at our local legislation and make sure that we're compliant with the obligations that we've already signed on to.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that the previous Minister of National Security indicated in April of this year that they were looking to bring in legislation that would be able to deal with the situation. I'm sure, as you know, though, that's enacting legislation
it takes a long time.
So we really have to keep monitoring the situation.
Definitely. Yes.
And perhaps have you ladies back on again
at
some time.
That would be nice.
As it evolves,
Yes.
I want to thank Fayola Cooper and Saelese Haynes, both lawyers, immigration lawyers, for helping us get some sense of sanity with regard to the situation here.